A seatbelt can stop you from going into a store. A seatbelt can stop you from climbing a tree. It can stop you from flying or from rolling down a hill. A seatbelt can stop you from doing a lot of things, like crushing bones and damaging vital organs. It can even save your life. That's why we enforce seatbelt laws, to save lives. So buckle up every trip, every time. Click it or ticket. Paid for by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration.
Hey everybody, this is Bunkhouse Bob.
And the lovely Mary.
Live from the Armory Wrestling Show is heard worldwide. Wednesday night, 7 o'clock Eastern Time on Blog Talk Radio. But this is an FNX.network plug, which means we're heard from Mobile, Alabama to Melbourne, Australia. Wednesday night, 7 o'clock Eastern Time. Check us out on FNX.network. What do you say, Laura? Everybody, Bunkhouse Bob and lovely Lori here. Folks, does the man make the title or does the title make the man? Age-old question with a simple answer. That is, if you're wearing a title made by Top Rope Belts.
Established in 2006 and with a satisfied client list, including Lucha Underground, the LA Dodgers, New Japan Pro Wrestling, Ohio Valley Wrestling, the National Wrestling Alliance, and many, many more. Top Rope Belts uses 100% custom drawings and does all of their own etching. That means quality from start to finish, folks.
Folks, whether you're a private collector, a wrestling promotion, or a business who wants a quality championship title belt, look no further than Top Rope Belts. Check them out on Facebook or visit them at www.topropebelts.com.
This is Thunder Kitty, and y'all are listening to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show.
Welcome to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, the premier podcast of indie wrestling.
We'll have to put out like a disclaimer. Sue Young says do not Google Taco Slapper.
Our studio line is area code 213-816-1605. With your host, Bunkhouse Bob.
That sounds like you don't have a lot of confidence in the Bravado Brothers against one Adam Page and Corey Hollis.
And the lovely Laura.
I don't trust that hobbit and that hillbilly.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. You're listening to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show. My name is Bunkhouse Bob, and I am the co-host of this program. Joining me in just a moment, as she does each and every week, will be the lovely Laura. Folks, we welcome you to episode 170 of Live from the Armory Wrestling Show. This is week number 5, our last week of our annual Women's Wrestling Month here on the show. Coming up at 7:30, we're going to have Miss Natalina Corvino on the show. Very excited to have her on the show. Good friend. Folks, we would encourage you to go over and check out all the good content, all the great content over on www.fnx.network. Some great folks had a good conversation. I want to give a shout out to Ryan over at FNX. Had a conversation with him on Messenger today. Good to hear from Ryan of FNX. This show 100% supports hashtag Project Kindness. We also support Ignite Advocacy. If you go to www.ignitewrestling.com, or if you go to Facebook and go to Ignite Wrestling on Facebook, that page, or Ignite Advocacy on Facebook. They also have a separate page there too. You can find out all kinds of cool little tidbits on Ignite Wrestling and what they're doing in the local Florida area. Very, very cool. Very cool project put together by one Miss Kim Hartlett. So make sure that you check it out. And again, folks, we thank you for listening, whether you're listening on Blog Talk Radio, on iTunes, on Stitcher, on FNX, all that other good stuff. I'm a little discombobulated this evening, folks, because I saw an image last night on social media that just had me, I don't know, just has me disheveled. The most important thing for you to know tonight is this, folks, is that if Laura shows up on social media, carrying my severed head around, know this one fact to be true. She won't be fired by the network, our network, FNX. She won't be fired. As a matter of fact, they will probably donate money to help her erect a statue of said image in her home state of West Virginia. It's unbelievable, folks. Unbelievable.
Bob, when I see you in November, I'm going to punch you in the mouth.
Well, if you take a picture of that and put it on social media, it might go viral. I don't know about carrying around my severed head, but you punching me might do some good.
I would never, ever do that. That's just, you know, that's just
what,
not
punch
right.
Me or sever my head?
Oh, punching is all right.
Okay.
Severing your head, no, can't do that.
Can't do that.
Nasty.
Well, I thank you, and my head thanks you, I think. I'm sure.
I'm sure your wife probably thanks me, and David probably thanks me, too.
Yeah, there's my boss. There's a lot of people. That would be a good thing.
Yeah.
Please don't cut off his head. We need him. Or whatever. So, how are you tonight?
Tired, Bob. It's been a rough couple weeks. It's, summer's starting up. Wrestling's getting hot. And so's the weather. And lots of stuff to talk about tonight.
Yeah, the allergies are kicking in. I know all about it. Why don't you... give the social media breakdown, and we'll get this thing started.
Certainly. I was trying to get George to run the Twitter tonight, but I'm not so sure he's had any success in doing that. Somebody in a little bit is going to be tweeting live at From the Armory, whether it's myself or George One Tool Coles. And also, you can tweet along with me and Bob at our shoot Twitter at Circle Sky for me, at Bob_Delph, and with George at Heel Heat Show.
That's correct.
We're also on Facebook. We have two pages, official Life from the Armory page. The other one is fans of Life from the Armory. The fans page is a closed group, so you'll have to ask to join. We have YouTube, which according to your Facebook post is gaining momentum. We're really proud of that, and thank you all for watching and listening to our show. You can find us at Live from the Armory. Just type in that in the YouTube search box, and you'll bring us right up.
Yeah. I was surprised. We should have done YouTube, or should have figured that out months ago. I didn't realize that many people just, you know, listen to stuff like that on YouTube, but evidently so, because we're getting quite a few hits on the episodes that we post up. So please keep listening.
Well,
subscribe if you want to on YouTube, and just click the button, hit subscribe. We'd appreciate that, and it'll come automatically into your feed, just like if you subscribed on iTunes or on Stitcher.
And, you know, you don't have to download another app, because most everybody's got YouTube on their phone in some form or fashion. So,
that is correct.
You know, you click that and, you know, listen along with me and Bob. This show is trucking right along. I guess I didn't really realize how many episodes we have. This is episode number 170.
170.
In 30 more weeks, Bob, we'll have 200.
200 episodes. Unbelievable, honestly. I mean,
it is unbelievable.
Overwhelming. You know, it's pretty cool. Nothing, you know.
You know, for two people that really didn't know what the heck they were doing.
We still don't know what the heck they were doing. What are you talking about?
We just make it up as we go along.
That's it.
It's been a wild ride.
Yeah.
And I have met so many people because of it and have made some really good friends because of it. For example, Mr. Steve Carino's birthday was this weekend. So I tweeted him the picture of me and him with the Rock and Roll Express fan club letter, which is due to him being on this show, and he liked it. So it makes me feel good that Mr. Steve Carino remembers who I am. Even with a little visual aid, he still remembers.
Yes.
And I would like to, the Gray Lobster, Stacy is looking forward to the eventual Gray Lobster retrospective on YouTube.
The Gray Lobster retrospect on YouTube.
Yeah, I guess he's wanting us to make one.
I don't know if I've got that much time to put effort.
If you quit clipping that bonsai.
Well, that's true. Who knows? I'm lost. We're 10 minutes into this show, and I am completely lost. I don't know what the hell's going on tonight.
I'm so jealous of you, Dr. Goose. You have done something I've been trying to do for like 2 years, is, you know, to shut him up, and you finally got him speechless. I mean, kudos to you.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. Unbelievable.
You know, Bob, you missed some great wrestling Sunday.
I from what I understand, I know I did. I know that there was an issue with Jack Swagger's flight and his wife. I know that they arrived late and had to do the autograph signing
flight
afterwards. Actually. Yeah. How was the show?
The show was great.
Yeah.
Had a great time. Got to see all kinds of friends. Jack Swagger is such a nice person. He really was very chatty. His wife, very nice. Highly recommend everybody, you know, because he's starting his indie stuff. You know, he's already booked for several shows. So get out and see him. He's great. There was a title change. Brandon Scott is now the new Prestige champion. He defeated Axton Ray and Caprice Coleman in a triple threat. The match that really, I think, one of the best matches on the whole card was the Power versus the Culture.
Okay.
And Mr. Montana Black made his return to AML. He wasn't in active competition, but it was at ringside with the Power. And that was such a great match. That's a really good feud in the making, I truly believe. And Zane Dawson and Jack Swagger went hard at it. It was a good match. It ended with some run-ins and, you know, a new face in AML. Zane Riley at the end did a run-in, so I'm interested in seeing what his role in AML is going to be. Another good match, I would be remiss in not mentioning this, was the Dixon Line versus the Heat Seekers and Sean Denny.
Okay.
That was a really good match. I felt that was could have been a main event, you know. Just some great stuff that AML's got going on. And then next month, my God.
Yeah, they've got
a
big show.
TNA.
Big show with Impact. With Impact. Called Confrontation.
Yeah.
I saw the flyer on that already.
Yeah, it's going to be solid. John and I already have our front row VIP tickets, so we'll be there. Yeah, it's just a great show AML's got going on, and it was great seeing Tracy and Brian. They put on a hell of a show. So, tickets are on sale for the confrontation at the Hickory Metro Convention Center. I don't think I've ever been to that facility, but John went last year when I had my gallbladder out. So he's saying it's a really good air-conditioned setting. So I'm all about air conditioning in North Carolina in the summer. So, you know what I'm saying?
I know what you're saying. What kind of turnout did they have there? And I was in Yadkinville this past event, correct?
It was the Yadkinville Elementary School. It was packed. It was a packed house.
Yeah.
I saw a lot of, like, Michelle Isaac, who is a AML regular, hashtag famous, you know, and Leslie and Kelly Michael are always at indie shows around. Josh Caudill, he was there. Our good friend Chris Riddle. How could I? I even saw Dr. Goose there.
Yeah.
But our good friend Chris Riddle, who I have not been able to catch up with since, I think, WrestleCade. So it was good to see him. He sat behind me and John, and we all had a ball. I got in an argument with James Ryan. His name just kind of escaped me. Because I was rooting for the power, and he told me to sit down. I was just like, you sit down. You sit down. But, yeah, had a great time. Lots of great stuff going on at AML. If you're in the Triad, especially the Triad area of North Carolina, and you're a wrestling fan, why are you not getting to AML? And I don't know if you're talking about this or not, but let me see if you are. I wanted to make mention of, you know, I felt like on 205 Live last night that I was, you know, somewhere in the Carolinas watching Cedric and Corey Hollis, Cedric Alexander. Because, you know, me and Cedric, we're on first name basis. Cedric Alexander and Corey Hollis. Because I'm like, I've seen this, you know. But it was great to see, you know, Corey there and making it, and you know, hopefully I think he'd be a good fit for the 205.
I would agree with that. I saw the clips. I saw someone actually messaged me, I don't know, I think like the last minute and 30 seconds, whatever the allowed run length time is on a video clip now, on GIF clip, last minute and 30 seconds of the match. So I did get to see a little bit of it. Good to see Corey, you know, at 205. Good to see Cedric back in the ring at 205. I'm expecting, after some of the stuff that I've seen on 205, I've got mixed feelings about, I'll just come out and say it, I've got mixed feelings about some of the signings. I'm not a huge TJ Perkins fan. I am a Brian Kendrick fan, but at this point, I'm more of a Brian Kendrick fan behind the scenes than I am in the ring at this juncture. Nothing against his – I've met the guy. Incredibly nice guy. He's still a great in-ring worker. Think that we're at that point where many more could benefit from his abilities in helping the next generation than we are by – including him in the storylines, especially when there's so much talent that is waiting to come up, you know, or to get into a better, not so much to come up, to get into a better position. I'm a huge Jack Gallagher fan. I'm a Cedric Alexander fan. I think Austin Aries is incredible. I mean, there are several people. There's a few in there I'm not sold on. I don't know if it was just, maybe it was just the overall hype of the entire classic and, you know, the excitement going into it. And now we're into the progression of what they're going to do with the division. So I guess time will tell.
I think you're right about that. It's going to be interesting because there was a lot of great people in that tournament who didn't get signed, unfortunately. I'm waiting for Cedric to soar. I'm waiting for somebody to give him the ball and just watch what he does.
Well, I mean,
if
you're looking for the next 5-star rating come out from the Wrestling Observer and Dave Meltzer, my opinion would be all you need is Austin Aries and Cedric Alexander, and you'll get your 5-star match that everybody's been wanting to see in the WWE.
Oh. Heck yeah.
You put that match together, it's there.
Yeah. It writes itself. And
yeah, it does.
I'm still waiting for the Cedric Alexander and AJ Styles rematch.
You know, here's the whole thing about that. Not so much about Cedric and AJ. And this is what I was afraid was going to happen is that because you've penciled these guys in as 205, smaller athletes in the cruiserweight division, it's going to be a difficult sell in certain aspects to move guys out of the cruiserweight division onto the main roster to make them contenders for another type of title. Case in point would be like Finn Balor. Finn Balor is definitely a cruiserweight, but because he wasn't nestled into that group, he is currently in a position to be considered, you know, obviously a former WWE champion. He's considered to be a contender for the championship again. Take somebody else out of the, well, so let's just say like this, is a Jack Gallagher, could he be considered for a WWE heavyweight championship? No, because they've nestled him into that group. That's the only drawback out of that whole affair. I love it. Other than that, they've just got them boxed in, and that's the part that I don't like.
Typecasted.
Exactly. Because to me, on television, Cedric Alexander does not look like a cruiserweight. To me, he doesn't. Another prime example is Tony Nese. Tony Nese, to me,
yeah,
on TV, does not look like a cruiserweight. But there are others that do. So I don't know. You know, maybe they can, you know, maybe there is a transition. Maybe there's a way out, you know, behind the scenes training, bulking up to move up in weight like they do with boxers, move up, move down. I don't know. We'll see. Time will tell. But that's just my thought on it.
Time will. I think you're spot on with that. You know, Cedric, you know, had to lose weight in order to qualify for this, you know.
Right,
so
and he had to cut 30 pounds.
I don't know why he couldn't put it back on.
That's true.
You know?
That's true.
So, we'll see. Just happy to see him living the dream.
Absolutely. That's the bottom line. Any type of critique that I'm giving here is just my opinion. And Lord knows that there's been a flurry of those on social media and a lot of people upset about a lot of people's varying opinions lately. So, you know, whatever comes my way, I'm willing to take. Those are just my thoughts. What else did you see?
You know, I know that Bubba and James Drake tore it up at FIP.
Talking about a buzz on social media.
I mean, I'm so proud of those two. I really am, because there's not two people, you'd be hard-pressed to find two people who harder than Bubba, who is Ethan Case, by the way, and James Drake. So I'm just so
that
proud.
That whole freaking
so
FIP
proud.
Card was outrageous.
It was. It truly was. FIP used to be kind of like the second tier for Evolve, and I think they've stepped up and, you know, like, we're here too, you know. We can hang with the big boys.
People were paying attention because the clips were going all over the place, and, I mean, they had some awesome clips. I mean, you already mentioned a couple of people that were on there. James Drake, Ethan Case, Anthony Henry was on there. John Davis
was
on there. Matt Lancey and Jay Spade from Wildcat were on there. I mean, you had quite a few little tidbits in there, and all of it got positive feedback. So, you know, a lot of eyes saw what they were doing over the weekend. My hat's off to them. What are you snickering
about?
Talent will
rise to the top no matter what limitations are put on them. One tool man, George Coles.
What did Coles say? What is it now?
Talent will rise to the top no matter what limitations are put on them.
There's a lot of things that rise to the top and float, George, but we're not going to get into a list like that right now. We've got other things to cover. We've talked a lot about the WWE, and then there's a couple of tidbits that I want to mention. The first thing, and I'm sure that you saw this, I want to give a shout out to a couple of people, former show guest Congo Kong, former show guest Caleb Conley, saw their pictures from Mumbai, India, where Impact
yes,
is finishing
so proud
up taping.
Yes,
so wanted to say, you know, hello, good job. It'd be very interesting to see, you know, the reactions from the crowd there. Some very cool stuff. Wanted to give another shout out. I finally got the clip today from former show guest Ryan Nicole, her and Congo Kong working in China. And the clips from, because they had limited access to social media, they were able to snip it together, different parts of the match, and put it together in a very nice promo package. Some excellent stuff that they did while they were in China. And I put that up shared that on my Facebook page. If you want to check that out, very, very cool to see. But all of this talk between Impact, the UK tournament, the UK championship, a lot of rumblings going on overseas. I think that it's important for people to pay attention to all of this overseas activity. Remember, we talked about the possibility of Jinder Mahal becoming the most lucrative WWE champion of all time in professional wrestling, based upon sheer numbers of fans in India, how long he keeps the title. I mean, it's a merchandise gold mine waiting to happen. This, I think, is just the tip of the iceberg. Mark my words on this, folks. I would pay very, very, very close attention, to what the WWE and other wrestling companies are currently doing overseas. I feel that this is a precursor to something much, much bigger. Mark it down. Mark my words. There's something coming. The other
the
big
answer,
news,
my friend, is blowing in the wind.
It's blowing in the wind, all right. The other thing that's been going around is the scuttlebutt and all the news sites talking about the WWE Women's Tournament, who they think's in and who they think's out. I can tell you, folks, I've checked around with people that I know of, and this tournament, the participants in this tournament, we can sit here and I can throw names out all day long, and it'd be hit and miss, like throwing darts at a dartboard. This is very, very tight-lipped information. There is not a lot of information coming out on who is going to be the actual participants in the upcoming women's tournament for the WWE. I already know a couple people that have told me that they're not in the tournament. We already know that. But as far as who's in, I'm just going to have to wait till the list comes out, because there's not a lot of people talking.
I've heard some rumblings.
I have too. And they're rumblings. I can't confirm or deny them at all. I'm telling you, it's hush-hush on this one, folks. I mean, we got a lot. I think that they were a little miffed about the number of people's names that were released for the Cruiserweight Classic and the UK tournament. And they have these people on lockdown. They're not saying anything. You're not going to pry it out of people. So, and if it is, it's coming secondhand. We all know how secondhand information works. So the last thing that I wanted to mention, and I don't know if you saw this or not, the drug charges against Sean Waltman, X-Pac, 123 Kid, all that, have been dropped. You remember that this was a booming story about 3 or 4 weeks ago. Waltman arrested in L.A. at the airport. TMZ jumped all over it, said that he had enough meth on him that he was going to be facing drug distribution charges.
Yeah, with intent.
Yeah, with intent, that he was some kind of meth kingpin. And come to find out that none of it is true. Not a bit of it.
Yeah,
everything tested false.
He
passed lie detector tests. I mean, and somebody was talking about this with Tiger Woods, you know, about how TMZ jumped all over Tiger Woods and ESPN. And, you know, come to find out that in the police report, Tiger Woods blew a 0.00 in a breathalyzer. He wasn't intoxicated. I'm not saying that he wasn't on something. It was obvious that he was.
Right.
He says that it's a combination of painkillers and medicines that he's taking, which is plausible. That's plausible.
Right. Yeah, because he just had surgery. Yeah.
So,
well, you know, with X-Pac, that's what happens when you tear, you taint. So.
It's no secret that, I mean, the guy's been in trouble before. I mean, he's self-professed, had addiction issues, all that other good stuff. I just thought it was incredible how it went. TMZ broke that story the day that he was arrested, and it went from routine search and seizure and arrest to the next post that they put out is, you know, that he's like the Don Corleone of meth.
Right. Well,
he's like a mule.
It's like Don Henley said, kick them when they're up, kick them when they're down. Everybody loves dirty laundry.
Everybody does love dirty laundry. Speaking of dirty laundry, no, I can't do the intro like that because that would be bad.
No, it's a good girl, Bob.
We're not going to kick her when she's up, and we're not going to kick her when she's down because she's actually a pretty cool lady. If I have this right, we'd like to welcome to the show Miss Natalina Corvino. Natalina, are you there?
I am here. How are you?
I am fine. How are you this evening?
I am god-awful tired.
God-awful tired. Well, I
came back from Maryland this morning.
Okay.
Oh, my.
Well, we're not going to ask you to do jumping jacks and, you know, push-ups and sit-ups and power lifts and all that. We just need you just to sit down and talk. Would that be okay?
That's good, because I'm sitting in my car enjoying talking to you guys and conversing. I love doing this stuff.
We can do that. With me on the other end of the line is Laura. Laura, you want to say hello to Natalina?
Hey, girl.
Hey.
Oh, it's all about the hey.
Hey, girl. Hey.
That's how girls do.
Oh, Lord.
Right, Bob.
Broke down already. Well, Natalina, you know, we want to thank you very much for taking time out of your schedule. We know that you're busy. Certainly appreciate you coming on the show tonight.
Oh, you're more than welcome. Thank you for asking me. I always appreciate when people ask me to do stuff like this. I really do.
Not a problem at all. Not a problem at all. I heard you say in another interview, when approached about being a wrestler, you said that you felt that you were not gifted athletically. How do you translate taking perhaps some of those negative attributes about maybe not being gifted athletically, hiding them, and turning them into a positive? How does that work?
A lot of the times I make jokes about it because most wrestlers, you know, they grew up doing sports in some way, shape, or form, or they were in high school wrestling or, you know, something. Me, who, you know, cross country was too hard for me because that involved exercise, and I was a very, yeah.
Right.
I mean, I visit my parents once a month, and once a year, and I was actually there yesterday, and they, you know, were talking and just, you know, they're amazed by the fact that, you know, when they used to see me as a kid, they would come and, you know, find me whatever room I was in, and I would just be sitting, and they would come and find me 4 hours later, and I had moved from that spot because I was such a lazy, inactive kid. You know, I was very overweight, very inactive. They didn't know what to do with me because they would make me exercise, and I hated them for it, and I couldn't stand them and fought them tooth and nail for it. And then they see what I do now, and they're like, what were you doing all those times you just sat there? I was like, I really don't know. I was just lazy. That's all I could tell you. I make a big joke about it, you know, that I was not athletic, and I applaud everyone that was because I feel that they deserve that recognition.
Sure.
My athleticism, quote unquote, didn't really start with any athletics. I just started lifting, and that just became more of my passion, which to a point, depending on who you talk to, because you have those people who don't feel that lifting is any kind of a sport. And then I go, okay, let's go to the gym and let's see if you can deadlift 275 pounds and then talk to me about whether this is somewhat of a sport or not.
Right.
Because it is, to a point. It's all in the eye of the beholder. You know, granted, you're not racing down the track and, you know, at full speed and seeing who can win. I get that. But there are people that can outlift each other, and in a way, that's competition. And that's what sports are, competition, right? So I kind of use that logic.
Sure. Yeah, that makes sense.
So with, you know, with wrestling, you know, I turn that into a positive as far as you can be that kid that couldn't do anything, mm-hmm. but don't let that affect your adult life by, oh, I couldn't do this then, so I can't do this now. I'm prime example of I couldn't do anything. At all.
Right.
I mean, right now, if you ask me, hey, can you go run a mile? I would look at you and go, is there a bear chasing me? Because if not, I'm not doing it. This is not going to happen. I mean, I'm just going to be that person. Go, ah, I'm just going to lay down and let him attack me because I'm just not going to outrun the bear.
Right.
And so I try to make it to where, you know, you can be one way growing up or, you know, in your early years and then later on change it. And that I try to show people, like, you can always make a difference in your life for the positive. You don't always have to live in the negative where a lot of people tend to stay. Like, I couldn't do this then, I can't do this now. Yeah, you can. So that's how I try to change it into that positive aspect.
That's just the natural progression of, I don't know, for some people. I would hope for more than just some. That's just the natural progression of life. Though, isn't it? I mean, mom's dusting you off one week, you know, because, you know, that's what moms do. You know, she comes in and checks on you and has to dust you off. But, you know, eventually at the end of the day, we as people, we have to motivate ourselves, correct?
But if you look at it to where you are right, it should be that way. But I'm using this as an example, and I hope nobody gets offended. But look at the people who they were, you know, in really good shape at one point in their life, and then they had a sickness or, you know, they broke a part of their body, leg, arm, whichever, and then after they healed, they didn't get back into it. Now they're overweight, you know, their joints hurt because they weren't staying active. You know, they forget. You can get back to it. Or, you know,
right.
Women who eventually, you know, they get married and they, you know, they have children, they forget to take care of themselves, and then they're in that unhealthy stage of their life because, well, you know, I've had two kids. Okay, great, you've had two kids. You can still go to the gym. You can still exercise. You can walk your children everywhere and still live healthy and still eat healthy. I mean, if anyone that's ever seen pictures of me, I am not a perfect body, so I'm not preaching that whatsoever. But I was borderline diabetic up until a year ago. And I, you know, got myself to where I'm no longer, you know, diabetic. You know, nowhere near that border anymore.
Congratulations.
I had high blood pressure. Thank you. I had high blood pressure so high that I was borderline stroke. To where every single time I went in for a doctor's appointment, I have a high stressful job. And so they kept, like, how are you not having a stroke yet? I go, because I just refuse to have one, I guess. I don't know. I'm stubborn. But they're telling me that there is literally a moment you're going to have a stroke. And this is when I was 38. I'm 40 now. My cousin had a stroke at 38. So I'm like, okay, you know what? This actually may happen to me. I got to change some things, you know, with myself,
right.
And Cation does help, of course, and that has helped me out greatly, but I don't rely on that. I relied on,
right.
I did my medication, I took it every day, and I started eating better, I exercised more, I tried to control my stress level, which just doesn't work out that well. Yeah, so.
Right.
Yeah, for real. But there's people who don't try to better themselves because they're like, it's not worth it anymore. They got to remember it is worth it. You can be 40, as I am, and 45 and fabulous. And that's what I did when I turned 40 in February. I'm like, I'm 40 and fabulous. I'll tell my age to everybody. You know, people
right.
are like, you know, like when you do like wrestling shows and they ask you, you know, where are you from? And then I remember one guy, he was like, I said, well, don't you want to know my weight? He goes, we never do women's weight. I go, why not? I'm a powerhouse. I want you to tell my weight. That's the whole part of who I am. I'm not ashamed of what I weigh or how old I am. So I make sure they say my age, or if that's requested, definitely my weight, because that's who I am, and that's, you should never be worried about what that number is. It's always about how
you
are with it.
I agree with you. All a state of mind. A lot of it is all a state of mind. Now, I watched tape on you versus Danny Ferrara, Matty Max,
yes,
former show guest, and Serrera 7. I watched match tape with you against her as well. Very straightforward powerhouse wrestling, no frills. I mean, it is what you see is exactly what you get. Is there a wrestler? Is there a wrestler that you wanted to emulate as far as in ring style, or has it been more trial and error for you?
Because I didn't get to grow up watching wrestling as a child, early adult, I didn't start getting into watching it until, you know, just a couple of years ago. However, you know, seeing the way China looked, I always wanted to be that. That was my ideal woman, as far as that's what I wanted to be. Of course, I couldn't be that because that takes a lot of training and a lot more dedication I can do. But the fact that she was a powerhouse, that's what I emulated. Now with Nia Jax, that's like, to me, that's kind of like the China now, as far as when she walks into a room, her presence is known.
Sure.
And that's kind of what I want to be. And what I think I portray to a point, or what I'm told I portray, of course, I'm never, you know, cocky in any way, but that's how I feel that I am to a point.
Okay. And that makes sense to me. I mean, that's legit. I mean, because you're not a high flyer. You're not going to be a high flyer.
No.
So,
if
I mean, there's
flying
no
flying somewhere, there's something wrong. If you see me going to the top rope, either I have accidentally ingested some medication I should not have, or I just feel really, really chancy that day, and I'm like, oh, I'll try this, which will never happen, ever.
That makes sense. No reason to try to fit a round peg into a square hole. I mean, it is what it is, right? Okay.
Right, exactly. I mean, and I leave that up to the girls that can and the guys that can't. I applaud them. I think I love it. It's amazing to watch. They deserve mad respect. I wish I could do that, but this girl ain't doing it. It's just not happening.
I understand. In watching that tape, there were two things that really stood out to me. Number one, you're a perennial fan favorite. The fans love you. I mean, it's obvious to see on the tape. The second thing that I noticed is that kayfabe is alive and well in certain areas. Because I watch just as much as the fans' reactions to things as I do as to what's going on in the ring. And I mean, they both walk hand in hand, really, being a fan favorite. And that. What are your thoughts on both of those things, Natalina?
You mean to kayfabe your real life to your wrestling life?
No, more about how important is it for you to be a fan favorite, and how have you been able to work kayfabe as far as your character to continue that popularity?
The fans are just probably one of the most important things, because you can be the best wrestler out there, and if they don't like you, it's going to mean anything. And like I was saying, I can do so many flips and turns and, I mean, blow people out of the water, which will never happen, you know, and, you know, people will not react to it because if they don't like it, or if they don't like you, it's just not going to go over well. They mean everything to me, because without them, I wouldn't be nowhere near where I am right now. I thank them as much as I possibly can, every chance I can, to where it gets overwhelming at times, only because I wish I could dedicate more time to be able to you know, return messages and, you know, people that want to, you know, like little kids that want to get on Facebook and they want to FaceTime me, and I can't just because of, I might be at work at the time or I might be doing something else. I just can't do that. And I wish I could because I know how important they are. It's very important for me to be the favorite. This, it's mostly the reason why I don't ever want to be a heel. I do heel every once in a blue moon. I hate doing it to a point just because I don't like to be mean to anybody. I just have an issue with it to a point. I'll do it, but I love the little faces, and I love, you know, how excited that they get, and I love hearing them be excited for this girl to come out and beat someone else up. Yeah,
right.
It's you know, it's very important to me to have that in my corner. I don't think I could ever handle being a heel for my home promotion, Pure Pro Wrestling in Pelham, because I would hate to just hear them boo me. I think it would probably crush me there. You know, other places I can deal with it, but I think there it would crush me to have them not like me for a certain amount of time. I don't think I could handle it well at all. And at least I can admit to that. Other people can then, I can do either or. I can too, but just not there. I would just not know how to handle it afterwards, because then while you're in the ring and you're carrying on that persona, I don't think I can carry on that persona outside the ring because I can't be mean to them. You know what I mean? Just it would hurt me as much as it would, might hurt a few of them. You know, I don't know how serious a lot of them take it. I don't know if their parents are telling them, you know, some of this, you know, they're really nice. They're just being mean right this second. You know what I mean? I don't think they always explain it to them.
Yeah, that makes sense. I can't remember which match it was on. I mean, just several fans at ringside that were adult fans that were getting up, you know.
Yeah.
Laura and I have talked about this before. I mean, there are certain areas that, geographically speaking, that wrestling is as real as what it was in the 70s. I mean, as in perception, you know, it has not changed. So does that throw you off, or does that just feed more into your character?
It doesn't throw me off. I love it to a point. My character really is just an amplified version of who I am. I am that overly tattooed, colorful hair, powerlifting, you know, listen to heavy metal music girl. I mean, that's me. And, you know, when I come out, that's basically, you know, what I am, what you see. And even, you know, when I do get loud, you know, baby faces are supposed to be kind of, I don't want to say the word, like, quiet to a point, but they're supposed to be more calmer. I don't stay calm. I'll you know, yell back at the person or stuff like that. That really is my personality. That's just who I am. So it's like I call myself like a heelish baby at times, because I'll get angry, I'll get upset, I'll show the frustration because I am frustrated. You know, it's hot and I think my makeup's running and I hate that and I feel sweat on my body and I don't like that either. And then again, it's like, okay, yeah, that goes into the whole thing. I really don't like running around, but I do it anyway. It's fun. The whole experience of them perceiving it as real makes it so much more better for us. We want them to believe it's real. It's important that they feel it's real, because then it gives us more to give them in the entertainment aspect and also the real aspect. You know, like when they come up to me and go, did that hurt? I'm like, yeah, that hurt. I just got hit with a chair. Of course that hurt. You know, that's what you want them to know. Yes, it hurt. So that when they see you and they're cheering for you, or when they're upset because someone hurt their favorite wrestler, you know, with a chair or, you know, with a stick or whatever they're using, you want that reaction, because that's what you're feeding off of. It's the whole energy that you just, you know, envelop.
Yeah, that's the heart of pro wrestling, that emotional investment between the fans and the performers in the ring. There are two women's only exclusive tournaments coming up in July, both for WWN. China's having one, and the WWE, as we all know. If we had said that 5 years ago that there would be two women's only exclusive tournaments, people would have laughed. I mean, how has the resurgence of women's wrestling changed the way that we view women in the ring? I mean, what they're capable of? Or is it just good business to cash in on this wave of popularity right now, Natalina? I mean, is it a combination of both, or are the fans and the promotions actually taking women's wrestling seriously now?
I think a lot had to do with it, and of course, this is just my opinion. Doesn't make it right, but this is my opinion. I think at one point in time, they over-sexualized women. In, you know, it's understandable that they did, but I think they were looking at, oh, this is what she looks like, instead of dealing with her athleticism at all. With them now, yes, they're attractive, but you're really seeing, you know, they're really breaking sweats. They're really doing a lot of hard movements. I mean, we had Charlotte and Sasha Banks had the first tables out of the chairs match. You wouldn't have seen that back then. That shows that they were willing to do what the guys do.
Right.
And you felt, you know, you saw, you know, Sasha hit the table or ladder. And I remember a couple of times, I'm cringing. You know, and you can see, you know, they're getting exhausted. You can see they're really putting an effort. And to me, and I'm sure a lot of other people, it was great to finally see that they were not just going with the, I'm going to walk out here because I'm hot, and that's it, and that's all my popularity comes from. They're showing the world that they can do what men can do as far as drawing in the crowd, and that's important. So now women are being taken more seriously in that aspect, where it's not just a pretty face or a, you know, a body walking down in this cute little outfit. They're actually doing awesome things. Not saying that women back in the day didn't, but I think a lot of people can admit they were over-sexualized at the time because it was a male-dominated sport.
No, that makes sense to me. I mean, for every one Lita, you had five Sables, or for,
right,
you know, one Trish Stratus, you had five Tori Wilsons. I mean, that it just seemed, I don't know, at times it almost seemed like by accident that these ladies were able to actually show their athletic ability. And then all of a sudden everybody's like, hey man, they can really, you know, they can really do this. They can really go, but you know, we're not concerned about that. Let's have a lingerie match tonight because that's what the ratings like, you know, during the Attitude.
Exactly. That was my point, is that they changed it. And I do think, to go back to your question about business, I do think probably someone was whispering in someone's ear, hey, if we did this, we might make a huge impact and ticket sales are going to go up and the women's division is going to go crazy. You know, so I think someone was whispering in someone's ear, or, you know, like saying, all right, you're going to do this because this is what's going to work. And it did.
Right.
So whoever was doing that, whoever talked into, you know, Vince's ear or someone's ear or producer or whoever, it worked out. And, you know,
yes,
women need something, or excuse me, girls need female characters to look up to. And they need positive. They can't always look up to that perfect, you know, tiny itty-bitty waist, you know, very large upper top self. They need someone they can relate to more, such as Bailey, such as Alexa Bliss, you know, such as Sasha. And they do look up to them.
Yeah. You're not kidding. They do. And I see no end to it in sight. Well, we're not going to have a Alexa Bliss, Bailey, This Is Your Life segment, but I did want you to talk to me just a little bit about your tumultuous relationship with one Nick Darden. Not the tabloid type of tumultuous, but the wrestling variety.
He is a
love-hate-love relationship, is it not?
It is. It really is. I think we're going to go down in history. I think we're going to make headlines. We've made some headlines already because they saw us from where we started. And
right.
then they see him basically screwing me over in every match I have where I'm up for my, getting my title back. And, we've come to blows. I think we've had a pretty good heat going, and that's just my opinion. To keep it going, it'll still keep going as hot as we can keep it, keep everybody interested.
Right.
And I think people are interested because it's all anyone doing this lately that I know of in the indie circuit. To where it's, I think it confuses some people because they're like, "Well, I thought you guys were friends." Like, and not today.
Right.
Yeah. Nick is a character. He is a, he's got his good. He definitely has his good side to a lot of people. He helps a lot of people. To me, he likes to take away my chances on my belt.
That dastardly Nick Darden. Unbelievable.
Yes.
Laura, go ahead.
You and I are Virginia girls.
Yeah.
You live on one end of 58, and I live on the other.
Oh, really? I live at Danville. Where are you at?
I'm in Galax, near Galax.
Oh, I know where Galax is.
Yeah, a little old Galax. So I just want to throw that out there that it's not too far from one another.
Right.
I'm friends with you on Facebook, and I see the post that you put out, and just some of the – you don't have any words for it. Some of the things that male fans message you that I think is incredibly important to talk about, and we talked about with other wrestlers and male wrestlers too, but I cannot believe the gall and the audacity of people to send you the things that they send you. It really takes your breath away. You're just sitting there with your mouth gaped open, like, I can't believe that people are this
brazen.
It's unbelievable.
Oh, yeah. it's mainly because these internet people. Internet's important, don't get me wrong. But for the people who like to hide behind their computer or keyboard or phone or whatever, none of them would ever say to me to my face, And I said this from get-go because I think somebody made a comment to me. And I left the comment up, too, because I'm not one of those people where, if you have a right to your opinion, that's fine. And this guy told me, he was basically calling me out for calling out other people. He said that, these guys have a right to talk to me this way because they're the guys that buy the tickets or buy my merch. I'm like, actually, no, they don't. But I didn't say anything. I just let the guy ramble. And he was telling me that I thought that I was so hot that, I was the only one that this happened to. Again, I know what I said and what I had said many, many times before is that I know this happens to tons of people, tons, tons. I'm just the one that decides I'm going to screenshot and put it out there for everyone else to see it because it's comical. Because of the fact that these people honestly think, well, some of them I think honestly think, that I'm just going to go, oh, yes, please, take me now. And, they're, like, appalled that I won't be like some of these other, not these other, excuse me. I know there are some women out there because I know some women, so I'm saying this based on experience. There have been women that I've known where a man would say this stuff to them and they took it as a compliment because they felt they were being hit on because, they didn't feel good about themselves. So someone else felt they were pretty. No, dear.
Right.
That's not what it was. And that their self-esteem came from that. My self-esteem mm-hmm. doesn't come from someone else giving me a compliment. And definitely not that way. So when this guy is going ranting and telling me that, oh, you think you're hot? No. It's just, I think this is funny, and I think everybody should see it. Because it's hysterical, and everybody laughed at it. It was great. It's I'm an entertainer, and I'm entertaining you.
At your own expense.
You know, yeah, and because, you know, in a couple of those messages, you're like, did your wife know that you're saying this to me? Because I can go tell her real quick. And they shut up. Oh, please, no. No, 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 please don't do that. And I'm like, dude, you know, but at some point, you're right. Some of these lines had to have worked because they're still using them. Because, you know, it had to work with somebody, and they're thinking, well, if it worked with this one, maybe it'll work with this one. You know, it's just, it's absolute craziness of how, I mean, I get weird messages too. And,
oh, I'm sure.
And people, you know, I have a picture of John on in my Facebook, on my profile. And I'll get people like, you know, are you single? Are you this, you that? And I'm like, do you not see the man in the photo with me? Are you blind?
And some of them don't even care.
Yeah,
why am I not getting any of these messages? I'd entertain some of them.
You know what? If you want a picture of a certain body part, I'm pretty sure there'll be someone out there who's willing to send it to you.
Now,
of the male
thank
gender.
God I don't get those. But
no,
ooh,
hold up there, swolled up. That's not what I'm talking about.
Now, there are some women out there who will throw themselves around, too, because they're like, you know, I don't understand them at all. That they'll just start messaging men randomly, and they act like men. And it's like, okay, have some self-worth. Have some self-esteem. You know, don't send it to somebody randomly. If you're interested in a guy and you've been on a couple dates and it's going to get heavy, okay, that's fine. That's your choice, whatever. But just send it to somebody randomly that you've never met before, that's kind of stupid. But as far as what you're saying about sending them to the wife, I actually did, and I mean, I'm not proud of this, but I mean, I actually did break up a marriage. But I am to a point proud of it because the fact of she doesn't need to be with a guy like that. She needs to be with someone who's not going to do that behind her back. So I didn't feel bad about it.
Right, and you shouldn't because you didn't do it. He did.
Exactly.
You know, you didn't break up that marriage. He did by being an idiot. It's just like you said, you know, people would never say that stuff in your face because, you know, you probably just knocked their teeth out. But
I make them feel very
like
small.
Right.
I've done that. Somebody did that to me in person. He talked to me one of those ways in person, and I made him feel like he had the smallest thing in the entire world, and he never did it again.
No.
Well, you know, sometimes you just have to put people in their place, but I just stare and wonder thinking, you know, where along the way did you think that that was appropriate to say to anybody? You know, I mean, especially, you know, somebody that, you know, you don't even know really. And some of this stuff is just like, you know, one guy asked you to beat him up, and I'm like.
Yeah, that's happened more than once. I've joked with my mother. I'm like, man, I should have gone to another profession. I'd be rich. she laughed at it, too. But the internet has been a blessing and has also been one of the worst things that has ever happened to the human population because it made it to where you can get your name out there, you can interact with people, you can watch videos of things across the country that you would never be able to see in person. And it makes it to where calling someone to say happy birthday, you're satisfied with just sending them a text and not even telling them over the phone to their ear because they're 100 miles away, you know, you love them. you know, or, you know, dating has even, you know, people think that, like, the guys, the guys that message me and they're like, you want to be my girlfriend? I'm like, dude, I don't know you. Even if I was single, I don't know you. I'm not one of these idiots that's going to meet someone, you know, at a street corner, you know, from someone that I've never met before. You know, that's just silly. You know, unless I've talked to you, like, at least a couple weeks or something. But, I mean, no, the first two sentences out of your mouth is, do you want to be my girlfriend? I don't know you. You got a job?
Yeah, I was
going to
start
the
interview off like that, but I didn't.
I really
thought better
you know,
of it.
Some of the guys that I've seen message you, I just don't know how you can pass up an opportunity like that. Because, I mean, these are some real winners.
Well,
I mean,
I tell my husband all the time, if he doesn't, I know, I tell my husband all the time, I go, you don't act right. I'm going to pick one of these guys. I mean, this guy promised me that he was going to give me a boat. And, I mean, I don't know, that's looking good right about now. You don't act right. You know.
That's great. Hang that over his head. You know, I got people on the internet dying to be with me. You know, you better.
I do.
You know.
We get into an argument. I'll be like, look, I was proposed to 2 times today. What are you going to do about that? And he just looks at me and goes, really, Natalie? Really? He's like, you go ahead. I'm like, fine.
Oh,
the negative experiences with fans. What is some of your more positive experiences with fans?
Oh, I love those. There's very few people who know my story, quote unquote, as far as, and that's another interview altogether, if you ever want to do that later on, but when this certain girl, I won't say her name because I'm not going to call her out like that, she was telling me about what was going on in her life. So I'm the friend that you're never going to get sympathy from. I'm basically going to keep it real with you, and I'll be like, look, this is what happened to me, this is what I did, and this is what I am now. So shut up, buck up, and fix it. And I'm kind of like the whole, what's the word I'm looking for, that tough love person. That's how I am.
Right.
And so I told her my story just so she would understand where I was coming from. And so after that, it was like, I never knew that about you, and I look at you at a whole other level, and you give me so much hope. That's what makes me love being where I'm at right now, because I haven't told my story completely yet out to the public. And so when I tell people individually, it seems like it makes such a difference, because they look at me and they go, I would have never have guessed that about you. I'm like, yeah, that was me a long time ago, and this is me now. You know, I mean, the small snippets to give some people not thinking, was she on drugs or something? No, I wasn't. I was very, very shy. I hated people looking at me. I hated to be the center of attention, which I don't feel I'm the center of attention now, but you would have never have caught me doing this stuff years ago, because I couldn't handle anyone even looking at me. I would actually wear my hair all in my face just so people couldn't see my eyes. And people were like, but you don't act like that now. You look like you have confidence. I'm like, I'm one of the least confident people you'll ever meet. Into a room like I own it, because no one's ever going to know. And I'm not afraid to admit it. And it gives them hope, and it gives them something to try to better themselves at. And like with the kids, they may be going through, you know, my campaign in life is I keep trying to do something about it, and so far it's not working. So I keep talking to schools, and the schools are not, you know, taking me up on my opportunity to where I want to do, you know, the anti-bullying campaign, because it's a big problem.
It is.
Right.
I was bullied. Yeah, I was bullied. And I want to do the whole, you know, I have a special way where I would love to be able to go in front of a school and talk to this crowd of kids my own little way, which I think would be extremely effective if no one's taking me up on it. And they don't know what I want to do, but they don't even want me to talk to the kids. And that bothers me.
Cool.
You know, and
yeah,
but when I have... Huh? I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
I said, yeah, that with me too. I mean, not even giving me a chance.
Yeah, and I've called schools and it just hasn't happened yet, but I'm not giving up. That's the main thing. But when you have little kids that look up to you, especially little girls, who, you know, they see, you know, there, I'm a lot of little girls' first time ever seeing a female wrestler. And it gives them somebody to look up to, especially when I can talk to them afterwards and, you know, sit with them and, you know, just have just a normal conversation. I've talked to kids from other states just over the phone, you know, just because their parents, like, you know, my daughter watches you on YouTube, can you please talk to her? Yeah, I'll talk to her. And it just, to hear them, it makes their day. You know, makes me extremely happy. And that's the best part of the whole thing, just to have people tell you that you're making a difference for them. Because I never thought I'd be that person to anybody, and it's the greatest feeling in the world.
I'm sure. You know, little girls especially need strong role models nowadays.
Yes.
Hey, you know, maybe we ought to, you know, get you in touch with Project Kindness.
I will take whatever chance I can. You can help me out with that. I'd love to.
Certainly, we can get you some information.
Yep, we'll message you. We'll message you the names after the show. We'll hook you up with a
couple great.
Because I think we think that that's a very, very valid cause today in this day and age. Way too many young people are being pushed into a corner without a voice, and nobody is listening. We see it every day on the news, every day.
Even adults bully each other, and it's ridiculous.
Yeah.
And I stay away from it. Like, when I see someone attacking me based on the way I look, and, you know, I flip it. You know, I'm like, I don't say anything negative about the way they look, you know, but I flip it to the point where they look and like, man, I do sound stupid, you know.
Yeah.
But I'm good with that stuff because I've learned over the years how to do that, to where I'm going to make the person who's trying to make me feel bad about myself, I show them, what did I ever do to you? Why are you attacking me because I have tattoos? Do my tattoos bother you? Or do you live with me? You don't have to see me every day. You don't have to look at anything I do. You don't like my hair? I don't care. It's my hair. I paid for it. It's my hair.
It's on my head.
It's right. It's on
my head.
I color it the way I want to. It doesn't affect you any.
Makes sense. The thing that I found astounding, because it brings me into my next question, you had said that you were very shy, very awkward, you know, to the point where you put your hair down where nobody could even look at your eyes. But a different opportunity you had this year was winning a spot on the Girl Next Door calendar as the upcoming Miss February 2018. Your album...
Yes.
Reached over 180,000 people, and I can verify that because it was on my timeline every day. And yes, I did vote. You're welcome.
God, that thing is so annoying. I hated sharing it every day. I was like, geez, this thing is taking forever. I hated looking at myself after a while. I was like, I'm sorry.
It's you on the calendar, not me. So it's cool.
Yeah.
How did you become involved with this, and where do you rank this? Where do you rank this at in your list of accomplishments, given where you were at before in your life, like you said, and where you're at now?
It's so funny because I literally was just sitting. I remember I was sitting at my kitchen table. Still scrolling through Facebook, boring. Oh, this person's whining about something. Oh, the sky is blue and they don't like it, whatever. So I'm like, look at this contest. Let me look at this. Click. Oh, these people have tattoos. Click. Keep going through it. I'm like, I got tattoos. I got awesome hair. Let's try this. Just for its and giggles. Only reason I did it. never knowing it was going to go as far as it did. And then, you know, the person, the woman who was running it, she actually owns three companies, and she was running the contest itself. You know, she messaged me privately after a couple weeks of me being in it, and she was like, look, please do not back out of this contest. I've had a lot of girls back out. I want you to stay in it. And I go, well, okay. I wasn't planning on backing you out, but okay. And she's like, I love your look. I want to work with you. Just please don't back out. I was like, I'm not going back out. I'm good. I mean, until it's over, I'm going to stay in it. Stayed in it longer than, I mean, it lasted way too long. It was 3 months. And, you know, every week she's like, just don't give up. I'm like, I'm not giving up. I'm sharing this thing every single day. Trust me. It's where it's annoying. And, yeah, I mean, it annoyed me. And when I finally got it, it was just a lot of explicit words came out of my mouth that I won't say. And it was just a shock. And then I called my mother. And she was like, oh my, are you kidding me? I'm like, no, really? It was February 2018. Can you believe it? And that was never really a goal of mine, per se. I always said once I started doing the tattoos, the big tattoos I started doing, I was like, one day maybe I want to be a tattoo model. And segue, I used to hate tattoos. I always said I would never get any big tattoos. I had this little itty-bitty rose on my shoulder and a little itty-bitty rose on my chest. And I was like, well, I'm doing. And then, yeah, you see what you see now.
right.
Yeah, it went totally 180, 360. And now in February, I was in my first runway show. Never thought I would do that. And it went over better than I thought it would. I was cast another runway show coming up in September. And then last week, I was just cast in another runway show coming up in August. And
wow.
I got another little thing going on. As soon as everything's finalized, I'll make an announcement. I won't say it just yet.
Sure.
I never thought it would be like this. I never thought the girl who was always picked on from the moment she hit kindergarten to the day that I left high school, because I actually did not graduate high school. I got my GED because I left high school in my second month of my senior year, which was stupid, by the way, kids. Don't ever do that. I was picked on my whole life. Now I'm a model. And that whole, just because you were one way at one point in time doesn't mean you can't be something later on. And that's kind of does the whole, just keep driving, just keep going. Don't ever give up, because you never know what opportunity is just going to walk right in front of you. And this is where I got to give props to Nick Darden. If it wasn't for Nick Darden, I would have never gotten my first runway show. He's the one that kind of pointed me in the right direction to certain modeling things. And thanks to him, even though he messes me out of my title, thanks to him, I've got involved in this stuff, and I owe him a lot for that.
Where are you going to be at coming up, Natalina, if people want to come out and see you wrestle and do your thing? What events do you have coming up?
I actually have, I just got booked on a show in Concord June 10th. That's not this Saturday, but next Saturday. From what I understand, I'll be wrestling Foxy Roxy. On June 17th, I will be in Buena Vista, Virginia. And June 18th, I will be in Pelham, North Carolina, again trying to win back my title from Danny Ferreira. And also segue to the Buena Vista show. This will be my second hardcore match, and that will be against Casey Dillon. So anyone that wants to see two women have a hardcore match, that's definitely a place that they're going to want to go to.
Where in Buena Vista is that? Because I work in Christiansburg, so that's not too far. Is it an armory?
No, it wasn't an armory. It was at like a rec center. Was the last building we were at. I believe the address is on the flyer that I posted today. I'm almost positive we are in the exact same building we were the last time we had Buena Vista, but I'd have to look to double check, but I'm almost positive we're in that building. And it's a really nice building, too, and it's air-conditioned, thank God, because I hate heat. really nice. Yeah, I don't like it. Summer, just I don't even like it. It was very nice. The Pelham Community Center in North Carolina is very – it's a smaller building, but it's kind of where Peer Pro started, and it's, you know, home base, and it's, you know, it kind of, everybody's all kind of tight together. It kind of feels a little bit more homey, if that makes sense.
Right.
For fans that want to get a hold of merchandise, whether it's 8x10s or information on where they can purchase the calendar at coming up, where can they do that at? Do you have merchandise at the shows? Do you sell direct through social media? How do you do that now?
Oh, yeah. I sell my T-shirts, my 8x10s, my bracelets at all of the shows. I also sell them online. I should have a way to just where they can order it, but I just prefer them to go through me right now. So they just message me directly, and I accept PayPal. I just set up recently where they can start paying me with their debit card through Facebook to make it easier for people, and I just ship it out directly to them. Also, with the calendar, the photo shoots for the calendar have not been done yet, been completed yet. I think the final, to get all the girls, you know, done with their photo shoots, everything will be done in August. So I believe in September is when the calendars will actually be out, and the calendars will be sold through me, probably through the actual Girls Next Door website, and I will also be selling them at our shows, shows that I'm at. I have this big tote that I bring everywhere I go. It's a pain in the butt. I carry it everywhere, and I sell everything that I can.
Okay. For fans that want to connect with you on social media and reach out to you to do those purchases or just to connect with you, how can they do that?
It's best to go through, my Natalina page has actually reached my 5,000 friends maximum. However, they can still follow me through that page. Also on my Instagram, I believe it's Natty2977. And obviously, pretty much everybody knows what my real name, which is the same as Natalina almost. And so they can, you know, friend me through there or message me through there as well. I hate Twitter. I don't understand Twitter. I do have Twitter. I just don't use it.
We noticed that.
It's
not that hard. You can say, you just need to sit down one of those days when your blood pressure is low and just sit there and work it out a little bit. Cause I'm sure that you have like 6,000 notifications and 6 million friend requests and all that.
I can't turn the TV on in my living room. I don't know how. Do you know why I don't know how? Because you have to talk to it. And I don't like talking to the TV. It should just turn on with a button and it doesn't. You got to talk to it and yell at it, go, yo, TV, turn on. And I just don't do it. So I don't use that one. I use the other ones that I know how to use.
I love it. I love it. That's awesome.
You can't get more real than I am.
I hear you. The last thing that we ask all of our guests to do, Natalina, if you could record an audio bump for us, if you could say something like, this is Natalina Corvino, and you're listening to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, that would be great, and you could go when you'd like.
All right. Thank you. Just tell me when.
You can go.
Okay. This is Natalina Corvino, and you are listening to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show.
Very cool. Very cool.
Woo! Thank Natalina. You so much. That was fun.
Yep. Thank you so much for being on the show tonight. We had a great time speaking with you.
We had a
thank
blast.
Thank you so much. Thank you. You're very well.
All right.
You.
Have a good night. Okay, Natalina.
You too.
All right.
Bye.
And there goes Natalina Corvino, and folks, we'll be right back after this brief message.
Hey, everyone. Lovely Laura here to tell you that old Bunkhouse Bob begged for a year to get Turnbuckle Cupcakes to make him a cupcake. And it was so good,
he can't stop talking about them in 2017.
That's right, Laura. I mean, what could be better than watching wrestling other than watching wrestling and enjoying a cupcake from Brandy and Julianne at Turnbuckle Cupcakes?
You know, they have other things too, Bob. Crochet items, cupcake click shirts, and much more. Endorsed by wrestling fans and wrestlers from around the globe, it's a no-brainer, which should make it easy for you.
I'm a wrestling genius, not a confectionery consultant. Folks, find Turnbuckle Cupcakes on Facebook or visit them at www.turnbucklecupcakes.storeenvy.com. Very, very cool to speak with Natalina Corvino tonight. She's a hoot. I like her.
You should see some of these pictures that people send her. And I want to answer some of them for, like, is that all you got? You take a picture of that? That's all you got?
Hold on. No. Oh, God. I have seen some of her posts, and she tells these people. She tells them up front after the very first opening line, which you can tell is just a troll. You can tell it's a troll line coming, okay? You already got the fishes on the hook, okay? The first thing she says is, you know that I'm going to screenshot this and post this on Facebook, and yet they continue.
Phone, and I'm like, did you think she was kidding?
I mean.
And then she'll post it, and I'll go look at the people on Facebook, and I'm like,
there's an old story, mm-hmm. folks, that goes something like this. Man walks into the doctor's office and says, doctor, it hurts when I do this. And he hits himself in the head with a hammer. And the doctor says, stop hitting yourself in the head with a hammer.
Yeah, don't do it.
Pretty simple. I mean,
it is pretty simple.
Incredible to me, some of the stuff they post. But all that aside, very nice lady. Get a chance to check her out.
Yeah.
Pure Pro Wrestling or any of the other events. Like I said in the interview, perennial fan favorite. The fans love her to death. Can't deny that. So if you get a chance, go out and check out Natalina Corvino at a wrestling show near you. Hope that everybody enjoyed Women's Wrestling Month this year. Had a pretty good mix of people. Had some people that are, you know, a little more well-known. Had some people that maybe are a little less known, but hopefully you know more about them now. And that's kind of the whole reason.
Had a ref?
Yeah. Had a referee. First female referee. Had good friend Savannah Evans on the show. Had Kelly Klein on from Women of Honor. Can't really beat it, folks. We tried our best to meet your expectations this year for women's wrestling.
It's hard. You people expect a lot.
Demanding sons of bitches you are. Yes. You want to go on and read off the indie events that we have?
Yes, speaking of demanding here. We've got a triple shot for NAWA. Saturday, June 3rd, the WWE Hall of Fame, Jimmy the Boogie Woogie Man Valiant is going to have an autograph signing from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. at the Pizza Hut at 1461 Blowing Rock Road in Boone, North Carolina. Boone is such a wonderful place to visit. I highly recommend the downtown area after you go and see Mr. Jimmy Boogie Woogie Man, Mercy Daddy Valiant. Then, Saturday night, 7:30 p.m. wrestling show, Betsy's Old Country Store, 8395 U.S. Highway 90 in Collettsville, North Kakalaki. Then Sunday, June 4th, Boogie's Wrestling Camp and Hall of Fame, 12 to 4, no admission fee, at 2916 Allegheny Spring Road in Charlottesville, Virginia. It's above where I work on the way to Roanoke on 460. If you've never been to Boogie's Camp, Boogie and Angel make you feel like family. I'm telling the gospel, people. It's a great little museum and Hall of Fame. He's got all kinds of people who have been there and autographed the benches, the walls, the ceilings. I mean, it's just amazing. Can't beat a free wrestling show. So come on up to Boogie's Wrestling Camp. If you want to know where it is, you know, send me a message. I will tell you exactly where it is. IWR presents Rise of the Revolution, Sunday, June 4th, at Gas Monkey Live in Dallas, Texas. You can find out more information by visiting www.imperialwrestlingrevolution.com. Ring of Honor presents the Windy City Excellence, Saturday, June 3rd, at the Frontier Fieldhouse in Chicago Ridge, Illinois. Gateway to Gold, Sunday, June 4th. At the Gateway Center in Collinsville, Illinois. Information for both events can be found at ROHWrestling.com. And before you... before we talk about that, I just want to say real quick that today is June Eve, which makes it 12 days to my birthday.
It's
so
what?
It's 12 days to my birthday.
No, the first word you said is June what? June Eve.
Mm-hmm. Today is June Eve. May
31st. It's 12 days to your birthday.
That's correct. And I just want everybody to get a good head start in the shopping area because, you know, it's my birthday. So just want to put that
out. Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Unbelievable.
Put that out there.
Hey, so your birthday,
you know,
in 12 mm-hmm. days. You know, I was thinking I could send you a message on a day that maybe you're feeling down, because we've been talking about messages and all that stuff. Here's one of my favorite lines that's worked over the years. Honey, you look better than a brand new set of snow tires.
And has that ever worked, Bob?
Only in West Virginia.
Well, I don't live in West Virginia, so I don't worry about it.
I love it. This is usually the point in time where we tell you who the show guest for next week is, but guess what? We're not having a show next week. I'm going to be out of town.
Nope.
Laura's going to be out of town. And there's no reason to try to finagle, bamboozle, swindle, or waste your time by listening to an episode, a best of episode, or any other type of episode, when you can simply go to FNX.network, you can go to iTunes, you can go to Stitcher, and you can listen to one of 170 episodes featuring some of today's best talent, including Cedric Alexander, Caleb Conley, Crazy Mary Dobson, Mephisto,
Steve
Brutal
Carino.
Bob Evans, Steve Carino, Matt Hardy, Diamond Dallas Page, James Drake, Anthony Henry, all the people that you're seeing across the headlines now, guess what? They have been guests on this program. So if you go to www.fnx.network, or if you go to the iTunes link, simply type in the search bar Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, do the same thing on Stitcher, or you can go onto YouTube. You can listen to one of these episodes, but we will be back on the air the following Wednesday, June 14th. You'll want to watch Facebook and Twitter at From the Armory for the announcement on who we have coming up for you on June 14th. So we're going to take a week break. We'll be back the following week, Wednesday, June 14th. And we'll hit with episode 171, climbing closer to that magical 200 episode mark. You have anything you
can
want
you
to
believe
add
it, Bob?
I can.
Well, you know,
I can believe it.
This show has opened up so many avenues for me. You know, doing PR and on a small scale, and you know, talking to people and just wanting to basically have little chats instead of, you know, being interviewed. You know, trying to find common ground with our guests, and sometimes common ground just kind of pops up and we don't expect it. But thank you to everybody who listens out there. Thank you, Dr. Gooseltron. I know you're listening. You always listen every week, and thank you very much. And we thank George, you know, One Tool. I know what he can be.
What?
He can be the one-man tool.
The one-man tool? See, when he said it on that episode, he said, you could hear him. You got to go back and listen to it. It's in the first 10 or 15 minutes. It's awesome. George, Mr. I'm a one-tool man, Coles. I'm a one-tool man, Bob. I'm like, what did you say? I'm a one-tool man. I'm a one-man tool. I'm like, what? I said, I told him I'm going to have to put it in an audio clip, and we are. Trust me, George, it's going to go into a clip. It will. One-tool man.
Thank you to everybody who listens to me and Bob and comes out and says hello to me at shows. I appreciate that. I've had people come up to me. And if you listen, I'm sorry because I sometimes get kind of starstruck in the reverse order because I'm like, they know me from the show. It's a little intimidating at first, but I appreciate everyone's support. And coming up to me at shows and saying, hey, please do that and let me know let me know you like the show and you know, hey, you know, Bob and I always take suggestions. You got an idea for the show or something we can do to make it better? Hey, just let us know. It might end up on the show. You never know.
You never know. Folks, we thank you very much for listening tonight, wherever you've listened at, however you've listened to the show. We'll be back on Wednesday, June 14th. And remember, there is never a bad seat here at the Armory. We'll see you then. Thanks for listening.
You have been listening to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, the premier podcast of indie wrestling. Listen to us on blogtalkradio.com every Wednesday night at 7 p.m. Eastern Time. Subscribe to us on iTunes. Follow us on Twitter at From the Armory. We're also streamed worldwide on www.fnx.network. And we're also available on Stitcher. You can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/live.armory.9. If you like what you hear, please take a few moments to give us a 5-star rating on iTunes. Thank you for listening. See you next week.
A seatbelt can stop you from going into a store. A seatbelt can stop you from climbing a tree. It can stop you from flying or from rolling down a hill. A seatbelt can stop you from doing a lot of things, like crushing bones and damaging vital organs. It can even save your life. That's why we enforce seatbelt laws, to save lives. So buckle up every trip, every time. Click it or ticket. Paid for by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration.
Ah, man, I love these Sonic nights. Shakes are half price after 8 p.m.
Yeah, but so are the ice cream slushes, and they're better, so.
What did you say?
Ice cream slushes are better.
Shakes are.
Ice cream slushes.
Shakes!
Slushes. That's it! Let's take this outside.
What a lovely spring day.
I love those begonias you planted.
Okay, they're actually hydrangeas.
Begonias!
Sonic Nights, featuring shakes and new ice cream slushes, half price after 8 p.m. This is how you Sonic. For limited time, only participating Sonic drive-ins.